So first off, sadly, the wind got the better of my audio in this, so in places it's not particularly great. Hopefully you'll be able to make it out. I did work on it as best I could, but it's not great, and there's no point in saying it is great. But rather than trying to re-answer all the questions again and getting it horribly wrong, as what happens when you re-answer or redo videos like this, I just thought I'd present it as is and hope you get some value out of it. That's it. Enjoy, if you can. And hello, good people of the internet. It is I, Tommy Kelly, and this is Adventures in Woowoo. This time, rather than a forest, we're on a beach. We're at Black Rock in the Secret Beach. When I grew up, this was known as the Secret Beach, and I thought it was a secret that only me and my family knew, and a couple of other people. But it turns out, everyone knew it, and everyone knew it as the Secret Beach. I did a video here before. I did some of the Stuart Wilde stuff for Patreon here. It's lovely. It used to be deck chairs and stuff put out down there, but it's tide has been in since, obviously, and it's very wet there now. The tide has been in every day since, or twice a day, whatever. Anyway, I was doing it over in a different place. It's the second take, and immediately upon starting the video, a digger arrived and started making tremendous amount of noise. So I had to move, and I was laughing at the here we go again of the whole thing. So Q&A this week. The questions have been sent in by patrons over on Patreon, which you can check out in the show description if you want to support what I do, and a couple from Discord. Well, the first thing I want, someone has left a comment recently, and it's not the first time this comment has been left, it's about not having the music underneath the vlogs. I know it's a very YouTube-y thing to have the music underneath the vlogs, and if, you know, it does add a wee bit, but it can become a bit distracting, and the balance can be, you know, sometimes hard. But it's also good for covering up, I suppose, background noises that are interfering with the main vocal. But I'm going to try this video without music and see how you get on. I think it works better podcast-wise without the music. And just see what it is. The intro music is my own music. It's from the EP that I released with the Corona bundle. And I'm going to do more music. And if I am to include music under it, it'll be my own music from now on. But so that's where we are. That was the first thing. Music or not? Question I'm proposing to you. Should I put the music underneath my talking in these vlogs, podcasts, or not? Abraxas asks, thoughts on the Fae? Now, the Fae are fairies to other people. They're kind of an interesting type of thing. I've no real experience with them other than being Irish. They're, you know, they're kind of prevalent about the place, and everywhere has kind of fairy forts. And even where I lived, there is a fairy fort or a fairy hill that was pretty much demolished to put a kind of a walkway. And all those videos, all those vlogs from years ago where I was doing all the running is down past where that fairy hill used to be. I never seen it. It was destroyed before I ever moved to this area. But the kind of the thing about the Fae is you stay away from them. Let them be. Don't go near them. They're not nice. Not that they're not nice people. They have their own agenda, very much like the angels and that kind of stuff. They're their own thing. And do not possibly, probably, have your best interest in heart. I have the Book of Oberon, which I've never read, which must do. It's a lovely kind of looking book, a lovely feel to it. And Oberon being the kind of one of the names that's given to the head fairy dude, I think. That's my kind of understanding of it, anyway. So yeah, my kind of thing is that they're about, you shouldn't mess with them. There's a town near to where I live, which I spoke about with Spud in the podcast, and it's saying basically that there's a very high rate of cancer in it, and it was buried, or it was built on some sort of fairy fort, and that's why one of the local people kind of, some of the local people blame it on. So yeah, I would say, going by all things, what do I think of the Fae? Enough to stay away from them, is what I would say. Dean Parker, how do you respond to people that might bring up the Barnum Furore effect when talking about things like divination, astrology, etc.? The Barnum Furore effect, as far as I know, my understanding of it is that if you do make a statement and generalize it enough, that people will think it you're talking prophetically about them or have a deep understanding about them that you don't have, you're just talking in very general terms, and it's kind of an effect known that's attributed to why people who read cards or do fortune telling or any of these things are able to kind of tell people stuff that they feel is relevant to themselves or deep knowledge about themselves, when in fact it could apply to most people. I first came across this in a book by Darren Brown, Tricks of the Mind, I think is that one, where he says, I've done this fortune telling thing and you're meant to feel that it's about you. and that it has a deep understanding. And I felt that none of it really applied to me at all. So the kind of a sting of the tail of saying that it obviously wasn't about you didn't really go for me. That's not to say that I haven't been, that it wouldn't work for me. I'm sure it would. There's plenty of things that, like the INFJ stuff or the personality tests, you kind of see yourself in them. But I did read some of the other ones and I didn't see myself in them. So it's hard to know. It's definitely possible or probable, and obviously it is possible because there's tests on it, and people have, or studies on it, people have felt that it did apply to them. Darren Brown talks about it in that book, that his editor thought about that passage was about her, as far as I recall. And the other podcast, how do you respond? If people want to argue with me, I just don't argue with them. I'm not interested in changing anyone's mind about any of it, or changing the world or anything. If you don't want to believe in any of this stuff, don't believe in it. That's just the way it is. And I don't think that's really that. What's the response for it? It does happen, but it doesn't explain away all things. Like, I went to a fortune teller once who knew the name of my dead uncle, who had died a couple of weeks previous. And, I didn't book the session, so they couldn't have done any research on me beforehand. And, it knew other names, knew a couple of other things. Like, specific things, not kind of a general, wide sweeping statement that could apply to loads of people. Very specific things about my life. Not in, you will travel abroad or meet a tall, dark, handsome stranger or anything like that. Probably knew the name of my uncle who died. It wasn't until after I'd come out that had described the person who had died recently around me and their injury, the head injury, exactly, and stuff like that. So that's not to prove that she was talking to the dead or anything like that, but it's that kind of effect where if you're talking broad strokes that you will, get people to think you're talking about them. It doesn't always apply when people actually talk in specifics and get things right and spot on. But it does happen, I would say, and it's definitely an effect to be aware of and to not, not get fooled by, but doesn't explain all things. Like, none of these things explain all things. It's one of the things that explains some of it. And it's getting a bit windy, so hopefully we're okay. Joe Forrest, what is the most influential comic book you have read and why? This changes, I suppose, or has changed over the years. My favourite comic when I was massive into comics as a teenager and then the whole way through was Cerevis by Dave Sim, which is a Canadian independent. It was the longest running creator-owned comic for a long while, in that the same creator did all of the issues, Dave Sim and Gerhard, but I think that has been taken over, and it certainly has been taken over if you look at any of the manga stuff. But again, not that that's, assistance and not necessarily the one... I think the one person doing it the whole way through, but it's debatable, I suppose, with Cerevis as well, that, Gerhard didn't do the first, 20, 30 issues. I think Spawn has now taken that over that mantle, but the longest running independent comic. Anyway, I'm off the train. So there was that which is hugely influential on me, particularly around artwork and her approach to comics, and that it doesn't have to be superheroes and it can have very serious themes. First 200 issues are amazing. Guys is okay, and then the rest I read once and didn't really enjoy. Other comics, FIFA Vendetta is probably the biggest influence on me in many ways, because it was the very first serious comic that I read, and I was very young and I was very impressionable, and it had a huge impact on me. And I loved the black and whiteness. I would love a black and white collection of it. As much as the colouring's fine, it's interesting, it's not my style of colouring that I enjoy too much, but it's it suits it. But I would like to see it in black and white. Just reminds me when I was 10, 11, sneaking into my cousin's bedroom and reading his Warrior magazines. More than Watchmen, even though it's way more flawed than Watchmen. Watchmen's far from perfect, obviously. Things like We Wouldn't Survive the Nuclear Holocaust, that kind of sets off the story at the beginning. Things like that. But overall, yeah, hated the movie, absolutely, particularly that Benny Hill scene. Loving Rockets, Jaime Hernandez's Loving Rockets was a huge influence on me as well. Just the artwork is amazing, and the kind of soap opera-ness of it, again, something that wasn't a superhero type thing, which is so synonymous with comics. Yeah, so I loved all of that stuff. I'm mostly up to date with that. I don't think I haven't read the last collection as yet. Then really got into the other stuff, Gilbert Hernandez stuff. The artwork didn't kind of gel with me, and I just never really is what I should. By all accounts, it's really, really good. Alan Moore was obviously an influence in different ways, other than FIFA Vendetta. Watchmen was good. Dark Knight Returns is a huge influence on me. Frank Miller's one, which are kind of, the same clot, I suppose, as Watchmen, or the same era, anyway. Recently, the manga stuff, Idio Asano, the Goodnight Pun Pun is just the greatest thing I've ever read in my life. It's unbelievably a masterpiece of comic, manga, whatever you want to put it. And I'm really enjoying his Demons, the Destruction, whatever it is, up to volume 8 and that. I'm bang up to date with the scanlations, actually, in a cheeky sense that. But I do buy the book, so. What do you want from me? But Inio Sano, yeah, such huge influence these days, particularly on the new comic. And Nakio Urasawa, which I'm definitely pronouncing wrong, he did 20th Century Boys, it's fantastic, Billy Bat, Monster, stuff like that. Really, really good. All of those type of things. So if I had to pick one, what am I picking? Goodnight Pun Pun, most influential comic. William asks, this came from a kind of a bigger conversation, but he's talking about how to do all of the different things that you want to get done, say magically, creatively, businessly, relationshiply, without overextending yourself and burning yourself out. And it's really, 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 really hard to do, and very easy to overextend yourself. And it's very easy then to kind of renege on promises that you want. There's not to see yourself and to other people where, you know, oh, you're asked to be part of this kind of a project and, you know, you just don't get the time. And it kind of seems like you're stalling, or you're not a man of your word, or all of these kind of things. But it's just that you want to do it. You just don't have the time, and you have to, you know, do I sacrifice my business to do this passion project and all that? But I have found, and this is coming from teaching music years ago and that kind of thing, is that doing 10 minutes a day is, you know, it's doable on anything. Like, you can do piano, learn piano, you know, 10 minutes a day. But if you're trying to put in 2 hours practice a day, you're probably not going to do that. And so you end up doing none of it. But you can kind of schedule 10 minutes a day. So I'd say to try to do all the things is to take small chunks and try to approach it. That if you want to do your passion project, say you're going to do half an hour of it, at least once a week, and start with that, or do 10 minutes a day, 5 minutes a day, and just schedule all the other stuff. I'm listening to Philip Glass's autobiography at the minute, and he's talking about what he would do. He trained his mind into that he would only compose for a particular 3 hours every day, whatever it was, 12 o'clock or 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock, or 3 hours, whatever it is. And if a thing came to him, if the muse arrived in the middle of the night, he'd tell it to go away, that he was only available between those hours, and the rest was for study or for all of the other things he wanted to do. So there's that kind of idea where you become very tough with yourself, that my business only, I only work my business between the hours of business things. I don't do emails, I don't do any other stuff, I don't do my taxes, I don't do any of the books, all of that stuff outside of business hours. Outside of business hours are for relationship or passion project, and go between 8 and 9 every single night is passion project. No excuses, no nothing. That's just the way it is. I think that's a good way to go. I try to do that, where I try and tip in every day with all of the different things that I want to achieve, rather than big kind of jumps of, you know, I'd say 2 or 3 hours on guitar a day, at least half an hour, and tip along. Because, you know, it adds up exponentially as you go along, rather than doing 3 hours once a month, you know, feeling guilty that I have to play guitar. If you do 10 minutes every day, by the end of the week, you have an hour. And then at the end of the month, you've got a couple of hours. So, Tina Frisora, do you test a vet spirit in some way to try and determine if they're beneficial for you to interact with, or that they are who they are called? I don't really work with spirits. I haven't in a long while. Not my thing. Probably should, but I have never vetted them. The only kind of thing I really do is that if I'm doing a divination, I will check. I'll do a first divination to see if it's the right time to do a divination, and that's kind of one way of checking with the 40 servants. And the other thing, I suppose, like, what would you need? You know, what would the process be that you would have to prove that it was, you know, the spirit talking about? You'd have to have some sort of you know, they would have to have knowledge that you don't have that you could then find out. So it's a good way of testing it. That's one of the kind of classical ways. If there's no point in testing them on something you already know, like, don't test what is my birthday, because if it's just a figment of your imagination, or it's part of your brain or something like that, then they have access to that knowledge and they will tell you. So one thing when people used to say to me that, you know, they're talking to Lilith or they're in contact with Lucifer or whoever it was, I would ask them to go, tell me what is the third book on the top shelf of my bookshelf. Stuff that they have absolutely no access to, and the person could never tell me. And I assume if you were Lysfa or Lilith or Daxhwil, these things, that you would very easily, given an invitation, be able to see what the book is on my shelf and have access to that kind of knowledge. So come up with stuff like that to test or to see if they are. And then, you know, just be careful with it all. If they tell you to do something that you're not into, don't do it. And, you know, even if they offer you something, say you did work with some spirit for a job and it came up in a different way, you don't have to accept it. You know, it came up different from what you wanted to come out. You know, it wasn't what you're actually into. You don't have to accept it. So be aware of that. You know, just because a spirit has said something or achieved something, you don't have to agree with it. And you don't have to feel that you are bound to it, you know, to that kind of thing. You should wonder what I'm doing here. I'm trying to block the wind with my hand. Serendipity. How much, if at all, do you incorporate timing into your magic practice? Moon phases, time of the day, seasons, etc. Why or why not? I did a lot of timing stuff, particularly when I was doing the sigil course with Gordon White, and I found it made absolutely no difference to my practice whatsoever, so I don't do it because it's an extra step that you need not take. I personally need not take. I know some people do it and find it immensely helpful and beneficial and really adds a booster to their magic. And the moon thing, I do sometimes take notice of it, saying that, you know, you should only do stuff you want, waxing, and you should get, you know, the magic that you want things rid of in the waning, do nothing on the new moon. And the full moon is, you know, whatever, it can be very potent, you know, it can mess with your magic. But just, yeah, not something I do in only that I didn't find it helpful. If I found it helpful and it did kind of increase what I was doing, I would definitely be doing it, but I just don't find it useful. Electro Wizard wants to know, what magic have I done that was 100% successful? Or 100%, you know, knew it was on the case. My hyper sigil them, absolutely all of it came true. It just, when I thought it was a failure, I was in the middle of it. And it seemed like it had failed, but I was still in the process of it. But once I came out of the entire process and the whole hypersigilness had manifested, which may or may not have fully manifested, but enough that everything came right. Everything that I wanted to achieve with that, it achieved and came to fruition. Other stuff, smaller stuff, definitely. I managed to get Grand Theft Auto 5 for free, and I got it within an hour for free from an unknown source, all of that kind of stuff. Not a dodge source, like I didn't do anything. I just thought I want Grand Theft Auto 5 for free, just to see, and it came very quickly. So that, like, I mean, can't ask for more than that. And things like that as well, little small things. The less I care about it, the more I'm able to do it, in that it's very, you know, easy to get Grand Theft Auto 5 for free because I don't really care, because if I don't get it, I can just buy it, or you know, it'll be a game, it's not that significant. But where if I was trying to get a new house or, you know, something very personally meaningful or significant to me, it's harder, and that's probably lust for results. It's also pendulum stuff, it's also limiting beliefs, self-worth, all of that kind of stuff comes into play. Whereas if it's just something fleeting that I don't really care about, you know, find €5, I can do it more successfully. Not 100%, obviously, in that, not that I can do it every single time, but it can come to fruition very quick. But loads of little things like that. I remember I was doing some ancestor work at the time, and I got extremely angry and screamed at them that they weren't keeping up their end of the bargain, because I was in a very kind of bad financial place at the time, and very, very quickly, the money I needed and more, like very quickly, hours or days or something like that, it came, you know, out of nowhere. Other things as well, I've noticed that once you break the seal on things, that, you know, particularly with financial stuff, that you know, you owe a certain amount of money, and then you, whatever is holding back or that kind of money, once that's broken, in that you in some way manage to let go of the lust of result or whatever, or you do something that gets you a small bit of it, seems to then, you know, allow greater kind of wealth to come in or something. I'm not explaining that too well, but I have done a number of videos on that before, so check that out. So yeah, again, to say, I'm not 100% convinced on magic being the thing. Anyway, like, it may or may not. I like it in principle. I like the idea of it. Doesn't mean it's true, but acting as if it's true is what I do, and it works for me. You know, I see, well, I know we were kind of talking in the Discord a bit about all our magic practice being a bit, well, for the most part, some people's magic practice going a bit by the wayside at the minute. But I think what happens is you kind of go into, you just approach life from a magical point of view, and that your art becomes magic, you become magic, rather than you're sitting down doing sigils to, you know, get sex or whatever it is, that it just be, you have more of an approach than a practice. And I think that's kind of where I am at the minute, like an approach. A little, the new comic is very magic-y. In the practical kind of sense of the word. So that asks you a question. Abraxas wants to know, his final question is, what golden girl are you? Well, we all want to be Betty White, don't we? But we're probably not. Although we're probably Betty White in Golden Girls. Probably not the smartest person in the world, or not as smart as you'd like to think you are. I don't know. Golden Girls, good show. The woman who created it is... what's his name? Sam Harris's mum. So that's my interesting fact is probably what my brain is trying to get out there about the Golden Girls. So I would be Sam Harris's mum. That's my answer to which Golden Girl am I. So yeah, that is the question and answer for this month. We'll be doing some more videos this month, but then we'll be going back to doing the divinations, the one card divinations that we do for patrons, and question and answers every month as well. So if you want in on that, you can join the Patreon, and that'll guarantee that your question will be asked or your divination will be done in the video. But if there isn't enough questions or enough divinations, I then go into the Discord and ask people there. So you have a good chance in Discord as well. But if you want to guarantee it, the Patreon is the place for you. Podcast comes out every Monday for patrons, the Tommy and Spud podcast, Tuesday for the rest of the world. And trying to do a weekly video on the new comic as well, so there's a couple up already. And then the standard weekly podcasts, the adventures and movie stuff. So yeah, good people of the internet, I hope you enjoyed the view behind me in the beach. And I hope the wind wasn't too bad. The Osmo Pocket's usually quite good with the wind. I hope my shielding in some way has made some sort of help. And let me know what you think about this with no music. And good people of the internet. Until our next adventure, be well, and may your best days be ahead.